needs to be overcome or addressed. Which trade laws are we talking about? I think the president's going to use a lot of trade laws. I think anti-dumping, countervailing duty for sure. But as Terry and Stacey identified, and as Gary Huffbauer and others pointed out in papers over the last year, Congress has transferred a lot of authority to the executive branch by a statute. So the president, I think there were 7 statutes identified there where the president can impose duties most of the time. It's conditional, it's temporary, subject to judicial review. But if, you know, if the president wants to stir things up, he has access to a variety of statutes under which that can be done. But I think the use of the AD and CBD laws are going to be ramped up under this administration. Now, before I assail those laws, I will say that I owe a lot to them. You know, my family moved from New York to Washington in 1973 when I was 9 years old. And my father took a job with a lawyer named Eugene Stewart. And after a couple of years, they became Stewart and Eikenson, and it was a firm that had very good reputation, representing a lot of U.S. domestic industry, big companies like Zenith and Texas Instruments, and anti-dumping provided, put a roof over my head, food on my plate, clothes on my back. And eventually my father went and started to put a shingle up by himself, the offices of Frederick Eikenson. Stewart became Stewart and Stewart. So Terry followed in his father's footsteps. Terry, I really think of you and I are sort of like stepbrothers in that regard. So I worked for my father over the years, and I had intended to go to law school and do the same kind of stuff, but I didn't like it that much. And I ended up working on a dumping case, the Bearings case, I think one of the longest lasting cases in history, with an economist, and I enjoyed that aspect of it, doing the economic analysis. So I got my master's degree in economics, and then I ended up working for Mudge Rose, a law firm representing foreign companies caught up in trade disputes and importers, and made for some very interesting Thanksgiving dinner conversations at my father's house. But then I worked for Wilkie Farr and Gallagher for a number of years, doing the same kind of thing. And then I came to Cato to head up what was called the Project on Anti-Dumping Reform in the year 2000. It was supposed to be a 2 to 3 year project. And having succeeded at repealing the anti-dumping law, Cato invited me to stay for another 14 years. But anyway, there is. I understand the arguments for it, but I disagree with them. I think the anti-dumping law has a problem. The countervailing duty law, I don't have so much of a problem with. I think there's a rational justification for that. But the anti-dumping law is premised on this idea that foreign companies are afforded some advantage because of some policy at home, some government policy, whether it's high tariffs or lax bankruptcy laws or something that bestows this unfair competitive advantage on the foreign exporter, which creates a sanctuary market, enables him to charge higher prices at home, cross-subsidize cheap sales abroad. Okay, that's a theory. But there's no anti-dumping petition in which demonstrating that unfair advantage exists. No petition includes evidence of that. All the petitions do, in all the cases, all the Commerce Department does is looks for evidence of price discrimination. Foreigners selling in the U.S. market at a price lower than he's charging in his home market, that's considered dumping. But U.S. companies engage in price discrimination all the time. U.S. companies, if you're a well-known company in one region and not in the other, you might charge a lower price to enter California, you know, if you're a New York-based company. There's really nothing wrong with that, unless you can demonstrate that it's the product of some unfair advantage bestowed abroad. But that's not even part of the dumping law. There are no requirements to demonstrate that. So price discrimination is considered proof positive of the existence of this unfair advantage when, in many cases, it doesn't exist. The rhetoric behind anti-dumping is us versus them, U.S. versus China. It's a law that's needed to protect upstanding domestic producers against predatory foreigners. But the evidence suggests that this law is used, it's more U.S. versus U.S. That's the proper rhetoric. It is predominantly upstream companies invoking the law to secure market power over their domestic customers. I did a study a few years ago looking at the downstream costs. 80% of anti-dumping orders imposed between 2000 and 2009, that 10-year period, were on intermediate goods, where there were downstream industries that had to pay higher prices for their inputs. In many of those cases, the domestic petitioner was a single company. And so these costs are pushed on to downstream industries. And under the statute, the U.S. International Trade Commission is not even entitled to consider the adverse impact on downstream industries when it renders its injury determination. In 2010, the United States brought a case against China to the WTO on restrictions on raw material exports, on 9 different exports, raw material products. And I can tell you, the way it was characterized by the USTR, Ron Kirk at the time, he says, China maintains a number of measures that restrain exports of raw material inputs for which it is the top or near top world producer. These measures skew the playing field against the United States and other countries by creating substantial competitive benefits for downstream Chinese producers that use the inputs in the production and export of numerous processed steel, aluminum, and chemical products, and a wide range of further processed products. He was making the argument that this is unfair to downstream U.S. industries. But 3 of those 9 products were also subject to U.S. anti-dumping measures. We ourselves imposed restrictions. So on the one hand, we are recognizing the costs on other segments of the U.S. economy, but under the anti-dumping law, we're prohibited from thinking about it. So I think we need to recognize that as we see a ramp up in the use of anti-dumping, there are a lot of mechanical tricks, methodological tricks used in calculating anti-dumping margins. I think we're going to see the Commerce Department perhaps resort to some practices that the WTO has ruled against before, where some people think that maybe the WTO has overstepped its bounds. Might be resort to using zeroing in investigations or reviews, see what the WTO says, decide not to comply, see what happens. Look, it's not, and it will be characterized by this administration as the United States protecting its sovereignty and standing up to a faceless bureaucracy called the WTO or other countries, when in fact there are huge costs to other industries in the United States. So there's a lot more we get. It's not just upstream industries wreaking havoc on downstream industries. There's also a case from the early 2000s on wooden bedroom furniture from China. Here is a case where a U.S. petition was brought by furniture makers, predominantly in Virginia, against furniture makers from North Carolina. There was the North Carolina industry had done some outsourcing and was supplementing its domestic production with furniture produced in China. The Virginia industry had done some outsourcing to Indonesia, the Philippines, Thailand, and they brought a case, and knowing that the non-market economy methodology would be used against their domestic competitors. The rhetoric was, you know, we need to protect this industry, we're going to restore jobs, it's these predatory foreigners that we're going after. But in fact, this was U.S., this was a civil war within the U.S. furniture industry. And more often than not, this is what these cases are about. Congress has passed this law. There is still broad bipartisan support for it that enables companies to invoke and to use it as a commercial weapon. So I think we need to keep that in mind as we see use of the law go up and defense of its use in this sort of nationalistic context. The countervailing duty law, I don't have as much of a problem with. I think that if there's a foreign government subsidization of exports, we need to discourage that. I have a problem with how the benefits are calculated, and I think that the process is subject to arbitrary and occasionally capricious decisions, but there is a rationale to countervail subsidize exports. Dumping, there's no real basis for it, so I'll stop there.
Thank you. Like my fellow panelists, I'm honored to have been invited by WIDA. We'll see whether you're all delighted after you hear my thoughts. or ravings, depending on where you come out and what I have to say. I will have the qualification. I am speaking for myself, not for any clients. What I say shouldn't be attributed to anyone that we may run across in a situation where I'm representing them. In a clever little educational piece, if you go to the WGO website, they have this website entitled "It's a Bird, It's a Plane." I thought it was rather clever. But the WTO concluded that it's above all a negotiating forum. And I think that I generally agree with the WTO's bird and plane and conclusion that it's a negotiating forum. Where I would disagree is with the way they put it, as an above all a negotiating forum, because I think if you really look at the GATT history, the Vanna Charter, the ITO, the GATT, and now the WTO, you see it is more than just a negotiating forum. It really is an essential economic and geopolitical pillar of the world economic system. In that circumstance, I think that the notion that has surfaced in some of the trade policy discussions about whether the United States should withdraw from the WTO is really complete nonsense. I mean, there may be issues in the WTO, but we shouldn't be having a trade policy discussion about withdrawing from the WTO. What's interesting, some of you may remember, there actually was an amendment proposed in the Senate a number of years ago by Senator Dole that if we lost three cases, the United States would automatically withdraw. That was compromised down to a privileged resolution about withdrawing from the WTO, and there were two privileged resolutions, both went down to defeat. But I think that we'd all be better served by this putting aside this whole discussion about withdrawing from the WTO. Nevertheless, it is essential that if you do support the WTO, that you accept that it's a troubled organization in transition because it has become frozen as a negotiating forum. And therefore, I think that people who support the WTO need to shoulder the burden of defending it, but also not blindly supporting it, because you also have the burden of shouldering the burden of trying to figure out ways to revitalize the WTO, which is going to go into procedures and also overall trade policy in order to encourage countries to use the WTO at least the WTO thinks is its overwhelming job, which is negotiating. In that context, Ken asked me to talk a little bit about the WTO and the relation to the rule of law. It is a critically important question in terms of what you do to reestablish the WTO's preeminence as a negotiating institution, to have discussions about the role of the rule of law. And what's very interesting, I actually prefer mystery novels, but I do from time to time read the history of the creation of the GATT and the WTO, and I was there for the creation of the WTO. And it's very interesting to look and say, from its very beginning in 1947 and even at Bretton Woods, there was a lot of tension between the poles of legalism and pragmatism, and how should the WTO operate. Up until the adoption of the dispute settlement understanding in the Uruguay round, these two poles actually worked remarkably well together. And in fact, they mutually reinforced each other. The current problem that's evolved under the DSU is that the legalists looks like they have essentially overpowered the pragmatists. And the rule of law is becoming rather absolutist in the WTO. As a result, it appears to me that WTO members now do not think much about negotiations to resolve differences, which was the whole history of the GATT and leading up, and also the Uruguay round, which created the WTO. Instead, we lawyers have succeeded. It is now a race to the courthouse. And this has caused, in my opinion, four core problems for the WTO's negotiating forum. Now, I'm 72 years old, so you can get me disbarred for attacking lawyers for those of you who are lawyers, but I do really think we have to watch it that the legalists have become dominant. The first issue is overemphasis on the juridical approach is complicating efforts to address major trade problems by limiting the leverage of WTO members that have already opened their markets to negotiate meaningful concessions from members and to expand to negotiation of new rules. Now, many of you know, I mean, if you really look at the great rounds, up until the early 70s, all the GATT rounds were about cutting tariffs. Complicated, political, but, you know, it's number crunching. I don't know who's calling me, but it doesn't matter. I should have put it on silent. You all are much more important. Let me just shut it off. I apologize. I'll put it on speaker, and you can all participate. But if you go back, the major breakthrough in making the GATT a modern organization was the Tokyo round, because the United States, you know, the light bulb went off and said the issue is no longer just tariffs. Our companies are facing non-tariff barriers. So why can't the GATT negotiate non-tariff barriers as well as tariff barriers? And the rest of the world said, you're crazy. And the United States used some tension. One could disagree with President Nixon did in terms of the 10% surcharge, but it got people's attention. And we launched the Tokyo round. The Uruguay round was also launched with a degree of tension as countries began to look at our trade debates, which led, you know, around the 1984 Trade Act, the 1988 Trade Act, and we said, well, we'd rather see you in Geneva than you know, at USTR under Section 301 and some of the other things you're discussing. So, you know, what's happened is that going to the courthouse has eliminated the ability to apply tension in the system to move people to saying we're better off negotiating. Now, when I talk about tension, it has to be skillfully applied. It should never be applied for protectionist purposes. And that takes skilled negotiators and a skilled set of trade policy people. But it is something to think about, that the rule of law, the absolute use of legalism now, is taking out the ability to apply tension. Second, and we have some trade negotiators in the audience, they may disagree with me or they may agree with me, over-reliance on the juridical approach complicates trade negotiations because it limits the ability of negotiators to rely on deliberate ambiguity to move negotiations forwards. The goal should be, let's get agreements. And sometimes to get agreements, particularly any of you who've actually done business deals, you know there are sometimes ambiguities in order to move agreements forward. And ambiguities don't always lend themselves well to a strict rule of law. Fourth, there's now a serious, I think, a serious problem. Third, because, and think about this, because the GATT decision-making process depended on consensus, there was also a strong incentive on all sides to recognize that they had to go to negotiations. The WTO's dispute settlement system now, by contrast, complaints have really become only credible if they concern a legal violation of the rules. So it's cutting off, rule of law in its absolute terms runs a risk of cutting off the ability to say, I've got problems, let's negotiate. And the answer is, well, sue me. The fourth problem is that I think that, and each of the panelists have mentioned, the U.S. has been losing a large number of cases related to our trade remedy laws. I don't want to go into merits of right or wrong here, because one can debate some of those cases, but I think we all have to recognize that there was a social contract that undermined all the political support for moving forward with a multilateral and bilateral trade agreement negotiations and regional trade agreement negotiations. And that was part of that social contract was adjustment, which I don't think we've done a particularly good job with in this country. And the other was that there would be laws in place to deal with disruptions. This goes all the way back to the Reciprocal Trade Act of 1934. This is not a new invention. In fact, dumping, countervailing duty laws are older than that. But this is all gave members of Congress cover. It gave people some sense of security that if they were going to be really disrupted by a trade agreement and practices on, you know, of a country because we opened up our market, there was some recourse. I think we just saw a big election here where those of us who are very strong supporters of the world trading system of open markets, we've got a lot of thinking to do about how we rebuild support. And supporting laws, one could debate the merits of how laws are structured, as Dan talked about, but these are important important issues. And you know, one of the things that struck me is as you listen to what some of the things, read some of the things the administration's talked about in debate, a lot of the debate about the rule of law today has sort of focused on should we comply with WTO decisions or not, this sovereignty question. As a general principle, yeah, we should comply. I mean, that's a rule. But it's also important to recognize in this whole debate about the rule of law that there are other dimensions that have to be taken into consideration when you talk about the parameters of the rule of law. First, the rule of law requires the WTO panels and the appellate body to not add or diminish the rights and obligations of WTO agreements. This really means that if you look at how we do it in the United States and how we other countries do it, yes, you respect judicial decisions, but there's oversight. There are hearings, there are investigations, not about whether the judge was corrupt, but whether they actually applied the law correctly. There is no real oversight in the WTO, and this was one of the real failings when they put the dispute settlement system together. I mean, if you compare the judicial oversight of in the United States or Great Britain or Germany, there's far more oversight of are the courts correctly applying the laws than you have in the WTO. That's an imbalance. Third, WTO agreements, and I think we have, are not the Ten Commandments. There have been nine WTO, GATT WTO negotiations. The rules have constantly evolved and constantly changed. Indeed, I went back and looked at this. There had been five anti-dumping and countervailing duty negotiations and agreements in the history of the GATT-WTO. To the extent there are questions about what or wasn't agreed to in this last major anti-dumping agreement, countervailing duty agreement, maybe it's time for a sixth negotiation. And that's the responsibility of the WTO to take up its responsibility as part of oversight and negotiation. Fourth, it's important to recognize in rule of law discussions that there are other laws involved. You know, we have laws in the United States. The Congress in 2002 and 2015 and TPA clearly said there's a problem with the dispute settlement operation. That's our law. So our negotiators have a responsibility to question. They've been told by Congress to question. Finally, you know, I think that my colleagues here have all sort of touched on it. There's going to be a lot of churning and uncertainty in the months ahead in trade policy. And I think, and we all have historical perspectives, I think the debate about trades is going to be as intense and complicated and as consequential as the debates in the 1980s. And for those of you who have never looked at the 1984 Trade Act and the 88 Trade Act, look at how detailed they were in terms of trying to shape U.S. trade policy.
there was a huge debate in the 80s about strict reciprocity versus reciprocity versus substantial economic commercial opportunity. This debate is going to be had again. And in it, there are going to be a lot of ideas put on the table in the weeks and months ahead. And I actually think that's healthy. And some of them should be just opposed on their face. Some will deserve strong support on their face. And some that, while different from the norm of the last 15 years or what may give us certainty and comfort, we shouldn't necessarily dismiss out of hand, but think about transforming them into useful tools. And again, we are all products of what we went through. I went through the great debates in the 80s. And the initial debates about Section 301 and some of the other elements of the law were quite disturbing in the way the Congress was headed. But the creative thinking and engagement by the business community actually helped shape some of those laws that they became very useful tools. So don't be frightened by things that might have some opportunity, because basically, I've always believed, and I urge you to believe, there will be a lot of confusion in trade policy in the months ahead. And while certainty is more welcome, we should not forget there's often constructive opportunities in confusion. And so we all should be looking for those constructive opportunities to move U.S. trade policy and international agreements forward to open markets, to prevent unfair trade and investment practice, and negotiate new rules. And in doing so, recognize what we may have been using for the last 15 years is going to have to change in order to get back on track and achieve the same successes that we had achieved earlier.